The very term Chalcolithic signifies the first use of copper and bronze in a lithic context, which means that a full-fledged stone tool using community first begins to use copper artifacts. Now, in the context of Indian prehistory, we find that such Chalcolithic cultures had flourished through a very wide region. The first sites are evidently found in Rajasthan, in the Malwa region in central India, and in Deccan. And the period ranges from around the 3rd millennium BCE. Today, this is the matter for our discussion, and we are going to talk about the Chalcolithic cultures outside the Harappan orbit in this lecture. And for this, I have with me my two colleagues from the Department of Ancient Indian History and Culture of Calcutta University. This is Dr. Rita Choudhury, Head of the Department of Ancient Indian History and Culture, Department of Calcutta University. And here is my junior colleague, Preeta Bhattacharya, from the same department. Preeta, can we have the objectives of today's discussion?
Today, this particular module focuses on certain Chalcolithic sites beyond the Harappan distribution zone. Actually, I think this period is very important in Indian history because it signifies certain shifts. Firstly, it signifies technological innovation, and on the other hand, it also signifies cultural contacts between diverse groups. This is a phase where the intensification of craft specialization brought about certain new complexities in early societies that we are about to discuss.
Chalcolithic culture represents a phase when the early farming communities began to use non-ferrous metals like copper, but in a very small way. Little change can, however, be seen in the socio-economic structure when these communities move from the Neolithic phase to the Chalcolithic phase. What we want to say here, that technology, whether it's new or an improvement, cannot affect changes in the other strata of the life of the people. The simple tribal non-Harappan village communities could not transform themselves into a more complex system that the Harappan people could of the Copper and Bronze Age at about the same time. They developed themselves into a more complex system which these people couldn't. They were contemporary with the Harappans, but they remained at their simple stage. And the Harappans had a nexus with them. They had some connections with these people. In certain parts of the subcontinent, we noticed that copper began to be used as early as 3000 BCE.
See, the Chalcolithic clusters that we have first encountered in India, actually outside the Harappan orbit, is located first in Rajasthan, northeastern Rajasthan, especially around the region which is rich in copper mines in Khetri and Baleshwar area. About 80 sites have been discovered in this region around the districts of Sikar and Junjunu and Alwar. And this cultural complex goes by the name of Ganeshwar Jodhpura by the type sites which were discovered first. Jodhpura is the earliest discovered site. They have been discovered in the year 1970s, around that time, and it has yielded a very early date of civilization. The first period belongs to a hunting-gathering community, and the earliest dates are coming from around the last quarter of the 4th millennium BCE. From there, we have a continuous occupation up to the year 2000 BCE. Besides that, we have retrieved the distinctive type of characteristic pottery, which is a wheel-made pottery ranging in color from orange to red, also from another site, which is Ganeshwar, located near the Neem Kathana area.
And what is the cultural sequence of this site?
See, at Ganeshwar, we have come across three cultural phases. The first phase starts around 3800 BCE. And it seems that at this phase, the occupiers were of hunting-gathering community. Mm-hmm. We mostly find microlithic assemblage mm-hmm. and some sort of dwelling signatures. Mm-hmm. But it is in the period 2, which actually belongs to around 2800 BCE, mm-hmm. that we have the first initiation of copper. And the copper artifacts come in the nature of fish hooks, arrowheads and spearheads, mm-hmm. as well as a single piece of copper awl, which is a sharp needle kind of tool. Here we find that the inhabitants were living in small circular huts of wattle and daub type. The floors were prepared by plastering with rammed pieces of rock or pebble. So this is the kind of thing that we get from period 2. From period 3, we find that there is more of copper artifacts. In fact, a wide variety and a wide range of copper artifacts are available from this time. Spearheads, arrowheads and fish hooks are there. But apart from that, we have the appearance of a particular type of very special type of axes, knives, as well as ornaments like copper bangles and rings. And we find that there is a sharp decline in the use of microliths, and also the kind of culture that we have actually denotes a peak of the Chalcolithic civilization. Okay. So these are the three phases.
In this context, can you tell us something about the cultural contacts that remained in this area?
Yes, yes. There is evidence for interesting cultural contacts. For example, the pottery from Ganeshwar actually resembles a lot the pottery from the early Harappan mm-hmm. context, especially the early Harappan sites of Gujarat. Now, it also seems that the kind of pottery that was found from the early Harappan context at Banavali was discovered as surface finds from the site of Ganeshwar. So there is probably a direct contact. Not only that, it seems that the copper that was being smelted and manufactured from Ganeshwar was probably transported to the Harappan sites in Kunal and Kalibangan. And that is a suggestion coming from Dilip Chakraborty, who thinks that the huge array of copper objects that we find from Ganeshwar actually signify the propensities towards craft specialization mm-hmm. among the people at Ganeshwar. And as you said, that these people were simple tribal folks, no doubt, but they had a specialized occupation which was dealing with metals mm-hmm. and probably they also supplied metal objects as well as smelted metal itself to the people in Kalibangan or Kunal or maybe even farther to the north and west. And we must remember one thing, that the use of copper bronze was a catalytic factor in the emergence of the urban Harappan community. Mm-hmm. So we have to understand that as a peripheral culture, the Chalcolithic context of Ganeshwar Jodhpura did contribute probably to the Harappan cultural orbit.
Tell us something about the Banas culture of Rajasthan.
We already discussed the culture that we get from the northeastern part of Rajasthan. Mm-hmm. The Banas culture is a contemporary culture but from southeast of Rajasthan. Mm-hmm. Now, we find about 80 sites belonging to a cultural complex denoted by the mm-hmm. first site which has been discovered, which is Ahar. So it is called Ahar Culture Complex, and since it is located in the river valley of Banas and Berak, so that is why it is also called Banas culture. Mm. So this is what is Banas culture. The dates range from around 2500 BCE to 1900 BCE. And we find that at Ahar, which is the type site, there are three phases of culture. The first, from the very first phase, we get Chalcolithic, that is copper objects. But very interesting point is that from period 1b, we have a few iron implements that we get, which goes, when we go to period 1c, we get a number of iron implements. And not only that, there is some sign of local manufacture of both copper and probably also iron. and this has aroused a lot of debate about the question of the early emergence of iron metallurgy in the subcontinent.
And can you tell us something about the other aspects of material culture?
Yes, this cultural complex is denoted by the use of rice, and also the stone tool repertoire contains of the food processing units like saddle querns. Mm. We have semi-precious stone beads, and so far as animal is concerned, we have the bones of domesticated animals. Mm. Like cow, buffalo, sheep, goat, mm. and pig. So it seems that it was a complete kind of culture which practiced mixed farming economy.
You have been to Gilund and to Balathal during the excavations.
Yes.
Could you share your experiences?
Yes, it is a splendid site. The Balathal is a splendid site. It is the Chalcolithic site belonging to the Banasahar complex. Mm. The both the sites, Balathal and Gilund, are located in Udaipur district. Balathal is very remarkable because it has a fortified enclosure. Mm. The fortification wall is built up on stone blocks packed with mud, and the four bastions at the four corners are clearly discernible. Mm. Quite a substantial wall. The earliest Chalcolithic phase is found outside this fortification wall, and it comprises of mud brick dwellings and mud plastered floors and mud plastered storage bins. But the later phases witness the development of larger rectangular habitation structures, which are built of mud bricks once more, and also stone bricks and stone foundation.
Okay.
And the enclosure is quite big. It is actually about 500 meters square. And inside it, we have three multi-roomed complexes with separate spaces for kitchen and storage unit. And there is a road running inside the enclosure from a northwest to southeast direction. And the road is quite wide, about 2 to 4.8 meters. So this is about Balathal. We have a number of different types of pottery coming from there. And we also have a number of semi-precious bead stones and other things. Gilund is also very remarkable. There also we have come across walls built of mud bricks. And other items are like, you know, the use of rice, dominated by some use of stone tools also. So it is quite a substantial cultural context which we find from the southeast of Rajasthan. Interesting point is that we think that there was quite a good lot of contact between the northeast Rajasthan cultures and the southeast Rajasthan culture, because we get Ganeshwar type of pottery at Balathal, in fact. Yes. So it seems that there was within Rajasthan we have two comprehensive cultures growing up in the Chalcolithic period, quite early dates.
Can you tell us something more about the material culture of Gilund?
Gilund actually has the same kind of cultural profile as we see at Balathal, but added to that we have some interesting structural remains. For example, we have a kind of a wall complex made of mud bricks with a stone foundation, which is quite interesting. And this complex actually ranges in size from about 30 to 24 meters. Apart from that, there are minor assemblages like microliths, then copper fragments, and also beads of semi-precious stones. Also, see, storage bins feature quite prominently at the site of Gilund. It seems that Gilund was actually quite a self-sustaining unit of village farming culture. Now, what we find from our survey of the Rajasthan Chalcolithic sites is that they were using a number of raw materials, different kinds of raw materials. For example, they were using copper and bronze, as we know, and the copper mines were located nearby. But apart from that, they were using shell, terracotta, faience, and they were using semi-precious stones like jasper, agate, carnelian, and lapis lazuli. Now, here lies a very interesting thing. ancient carnelian beads and beads of lapis lazuli have been recovered from the Rajasthan Chalcolithic sites. Okay. And these beads are very typical of the Harappan culture. Mm. So it seems that there might have been some kind of cultural connection between the Gujarat Harappans, at least, because ancient carnelian beads are a typical feature of the Gujarat Harappans. And probably that culture and the item had traveled from Gujarat into the Rajasthan Chalcolithic complex.
Rita Lee, can you tell us something about the pottery assemblage and the general material culture altogether?
Well, the region has produced pottery of an astounding variety. Apart from redware, tanware, red and blackware and buff colored ware, we have a different kind of reserved slipware, which has a very thin red colored decoration on it, painted on it, and a very thick red slip with incised designs. If you talk about the copper artifacts, we have choppers, razors, knives, chisels, arrowheads, all made of copper, but then direct evidence of copper smelting is very rare, or we do not have it at all. Then about if you see the remnants of animal bones, we have enough evidence of domesticated animals, including cattle, buffalo, sheep, goat, pigs, etc. Then plant remains include wheat, barley, two types of millets, green and black gram, and peas, lentils, and all, etc. Apart from these, we have some other objects like semi-precious stone beads. Then we have terracotta balls. We have again grinders, hammer stones, and stone kerns. Then about ornaments, we have terracotta necklaces and bangles made of shell, then copper and other kinds of stones and all. So all these indicate that there was a kind of craft specialization in this region.
So this is an interesting point that you have raised, and about this Dilip Chakraborty had spoken. Although there may not be much direct evidence available from the Rajasthan Chalcolithic sites about local metal smelting, but at Ahar we have copper slag and fragments which probably indicate local smelting and local manufacture of copper objects. And from given the kind of array of copper objects that we find from both the Northeast and Rajasthan cultures and in the Southeast, it seems that we can definitely, although we do not have direct evidence for smelting, but we can definitely put the Rajasthan Chalcolithic on the map of the total Indian prehistoric metal innovations. So that way, I think there was a large-scale contribution. Rita, could you tell us something about the Chalcolithic cultures from central India?
Well, the Chalcolithic cultures or the phase in central India starts with the cultural complex known as Kayatha after the type site. This is datable down to the late 3000 BCE, and it lies on the Malwa Plateau, which is very rich and fertile and is washed by various rivers such as the Narmada, Betwa, Shipra and other rivers also. Now, parts of Malwa had close connection with Harappan Gujarat, but the exact Harappan cultural phase in Malwa is ill-defined and very vague. About the type site area of Kayatha, we have a distinctive thick brown slipped pottery, and apart from this, we have a buff colored pottery and the comb redware. Then if you want to know about the other aspects of material culture, we have mud and reed houses with mud plastered floors. Then we have bone remnants of domesticated animals like cattle and horses. We have stone and a microlithic blade industry and an elaborate copper assemblage, copper repertoire, which which includes a large number of copper objects.
Kayatha, we find very distinctive type of axis which is cast in mold. This is very interesting. And apart from that, we also have copper chisels and ornaments like copper bangles. Mm. Now, another interesting thing is that the axis from Kayatha resemble the Ganeshwar axis. So there seems to be some kind of a cultural connections between the two Chalcolithic cultures from zones to these two zones, and also there might have been connections with the Harappan culture, because the steatite beads from Kayatha resemble the Harappan specimens, and also the pottery from Kayatha resemble the Harappan pottery. So it seems that all these three regions, the Malwa Kayatha culture and the culture from Ganeshwar, as well as the Harappan cultures, might have been interlinked.
Interestingly, at about 1800 BC, the site was abandoned, but it resurfaced once again as a center of the Ahar culture, a subsequent Ahar culture. Ahar phrases of culture is also present in Kayatha and other sites of the Chambal Valley. So we see that there are also other sites where we find remnants of copper artifacts. So we probably wider use of copper is indicated by them.
The most striking feature of the material culture is the typical red and black pottery that we get from the site, and these have white designs painted on them, and the other striking feature is of course the blade tool industry. Mm-hmm. And about the other cultural items, we have terracotta figurines, mostly of animals. Some are quite naturalistic, while others are more stylized figurines. The houses of this region closely resemble the Ahar culture dwellings. And another striking feature is, of course, the marginal use of copper in this region.
So we have noted the early phases of Chalcolithic culture in central India, the first phase being the Ahar culture and the second phase being the Kayatha culture discussed by Rita. Mm. Now, Prita, can you tell us something about the Malwa culture, which is the third phase?
This culture is marked by a very typical pottery with a very thick, coarse core, and it has a thick puff slip. And about the structural remains of this period, we have mostly wattle and daub houses with lime plastered floors, and you also have wooden posts which probably supported the roof. About the crop pattern, you have different varieties of wheat and linseed, green gram, black gram, and several kinds of pulses. The structural remains at Nagda are very striking because there we have the use of mud bricks. And in Iran, we have huge mud ramparts and also a moat.
Nupur, can you tell us something about the craft items from this region?
Basically, it seems that the microlithic blade assemblage is the most prominent one. And this has been signified by H.D. Sankalia himself. But there are certain copper tools available here, like the copper axis with the round indentation marks resembling the copper axis from Ganeshwar, as well as we have copper chisels and some copper bangles. There is also a sign of alloying with both tin and lead. So that is about the metal repertoire. But apart from that, we have a huge assemblage of semi-precious stone beads made of shell and jasper, agate, lapis lazuli, carnelian, etc. It's quite a sizable amount of cultural assemblage that we get from here. And all in all, we can say that the Chalcolithic assemblage from central India was almost similar in profile to that of Rajasthan. There was also a continuity from Rajasthan, especially from the southern southeastern part of Rajasthan into the Malwa Plateau. And this was a corridor, it seems. And there was some kind of connectivity between the two regions and the cultures. And through the southeastern and Rajasthan, southeastern Rajasthan and northeastern Rajasthan cultures, probably the central Indian cultural complex had access to the Harappans also.
Preeta Di, can you tell us something about the religious practices?
Of course. Some of the objects portray their religious beliefs. At the earliest level in Navdatoli, we have found a pit which probably has a ritualistic implication.
Okay.
The walls and the floor were plastered, and in it we have found charred wood, which indicates some kind of maybe they were used for some kind of sacrifices, something. And even on the middle of the floor of a house, we have found charred wood. May have had the same implication. Now, very significant is a find of a huge storage jar on which we find the image of a shrine done in an applique technique. And on the right side, we have the picture of a woman, and the left, that of a lizard. We don't know the significance of this, but it may have been used for some ritualistic purposes. Then again, one of the scholars, Wakankar, has said that at Dangwada, he has found a combination of a female torso and a phallus. Maybe this was used as some kind of ritual.
Fertility ritual, maybe. Yes.
And then we have a profusion of bull images. Maybe they were used for this similar purpose, but Wakankar has said that in the subsequent period, this image gave way to conical cult objects which have been found in houses and in shrines. Another find is that of circular fire altars.
Okay.
All this indicates some kind of religious belief prevalent in that region.
In itself, the Chalcolithic complex from central India had its own local traits, the regional traits, which were growing from within, but with also a lot of connections with the external cultures, with which sometimes they grew up together, like the connections between the Ahar culture in Malwa. So that is another site. And also we find, for example, the religious belief systems that you have talked about, it seems that it had the region had its own complex system of belief, and in that probably it was distinguished from whatever is experienced in the Rajasthan Chalcolithic. And also we find that so far as the use of copper is concerned, it is much scarcer in the central Indian complex than in Rajasthan, probably due to the availability of copper, which is nearer to Rajasthan, and whereas in central India we do not have much access. Or it could have been that the culture was oriented towards more use of stone tools, microlithic blades, and less use of copper. So it seems that although there was overall cultural connections, there was also some kind of indigenous roots from within. Rita Choudhury, head of the Department of Ancient Indian History and Culture, Department of Calcutta University. And here is my junior colleague, Preeta Bhattacharya, from the same department. Preeta, can we have the objectives of today's discussion?
Today, this particular module focuses on certain Chalcolithic sites beyond the Harappan distribution zone. Actually, I think this period is very important in Indian history because it signifies certain shifts. Firstly, it signifies technological innovation, and on the other hand, it also signifies
that technology, whether it's new or an improvement, cannot affect changes in the other strata of the life of the people. The simple tribal non-Harappan village communities could not transform themselves into a more complex system that the Harappan people could of the Copper and Bronze Age at about the same time. They developed themselves into a more complex system which these people couldn't. They were contemporary with the Harappans, but they remained at their simple stage. But and the Harappans had a nexus with them. They had some connections with these people. In certain parts,
the very term Chalcolithic signifies the first use of copper and bronze in a lithic context, which means that a full-fledged stone tool using community first begins to use copper artifacts. Now, in the context,
cultural contacts between diverse groups, this is a phase where the intensification of craft specialization brought about certain new complexities in early societies that we are about to discuss.
Chalcolithic culture represents a phase when the early farming communities began to use non-ferrous metals like copper, but in a very small way. Little change can, however, be seen in the socio-economic structure when these communities move from the Neolithic phase to the Chalcolithic phase. What we want to say here,
in the context of Indian prehistory, we find that such Chalcolithic cultures had flourished through a very wide region. The first sites are evidently found in Rajasthan, in the Malwa region in central India, and in Deccan. And the period ranges from around the 3rd millennium BCE. Today, this is the matter for our discussion, and we are going to talk about the Chalcolithic cultures outside the Harappan orbit in this lecture. And for this, I have with me my two colleagues from the Department of Ancient Indian History and Culture of Calcutta University. This is Dr.